From New York, this is Democracy Now!
I don't think reparations for something that happened 150 years ago for whom none of us currently living are responsible is a good idea. We've tried to deal with our original sin of slavery by fighting a civil war, by passing landmark civil rights legislation. We've elected an African-American president.
As Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell dismisses growing calls for the U.S. to pay reparations for slavery, the House holds a historic hearing on reparations to mark the anniversary of Juneteenth. Speakers included the acclaimed writer Ta-Nehisi Coates.
Enslavement reigned for 250 years on these shores. When it ended, this country could have extended its hallowed principles, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness to all, regardless of color. But America had other principles in mind. And so, for a century after the Civil War, black people were subjected to a relentless campaign of terror, a campaign that extended well into the lifetime of Majority Leader McConnell.
Ta-Nehisi Coates will join us for the hour. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Iran's announced it shot down a U.S. Navy drone, claiming it entered Iranian airspace. Unnamed U.S. officials have confirmed a drone was shot down, but claimed it was in international territory. The head of Iran's Islamic Revolutionary Guard, Major General Hossein Salami, said the incident should send a, quote, clear message to America not to cross Iran's border. The incident comes as tension continues to escalate between the two nations. On Tuesday, the United States announced it was sending 1,000 more troops to the region. Last week, the United States blamed Iran for attacking two oil tankers in the Gulf of Oman, despite a lack of any confirmed evidence. Iran has denied the attacks and has repeatedly said it's not seeking war with the U.S. The U.S. Navy said Wednesday fragments from a mine that allegedly struck a Japanese-owned tanker last week bear a strong resemblance to an Iranian mine. However, the president of the Japanese company that owns the tanker has said the vessel was not attacked by mines, but two flying objects. The UN and other international actors have called for restraint and a de-escalation of tensions. Meanwhile, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo and other top Trump officials have reportedly been linking Iran to al-Qaeda and the Taliban during closed-door briefings with lawmakers in what Democrats fear could be part of a plan to invoke the 2001 authorization for the use of military force to attack Iran. During a tense hearing before House Democrats Wednesday, the State Department's special representative for Iran, Brian Hook, was grilled about the president's authority to declare war. This is California Congressmember Ted Lieu questioning Brian Hook.
So under our Constitution, does the president have the power to declare war?
I think this is a discussion.
It's not a trick question.
Again.
Under our Constitution, does the president have the power to declare war? It's just a yes or no. Okay. All right. Let me make it really easy for you. Under the Constitution, Congress has the power to declare war, correct? It's not a trick question, sir. Have you read the Constitution?
We will do everything we are required to do.
Mr. Hook, have you read the Constitution?
I have read the Constitution.
Okay. Under the Constitution, the framers gave Congress the power to declare war, correct? Just a yes or no.
My understanding is that we're here to talk about Iran foreign policy, which I can do.
State Department Special Representative to Iran, Brian Hook, did not respond to the question. On Wednesday, the House Judiciary Panel held a historic hearing on reparations for slavery, the first of its kind in over a decade. Lawmakers are considering a bill that would create a commission to study the effects of slavery and make recommendations to Congress, including a formal apology for slavery. This is actor and activist Danny Glover.
A national reparations policy is a moral, democratic, and economic imperative. I sit here as the great-grandson of a former slave, Mary Brown, who was freed by the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1, 1863. Despite much progress over the centuries. This hearing is yet another important step in the long and heroic struggle of African Americans to secure reparations for the damages inflicted by enslavement and post-emancipation and racial exclusionary policies.
Acclaimed author Ta-Nehisi Coates was the lead-off speaker at yesterday's hearing. He will join us for the hour after headlines. Former Vice President and 2020 presidential candidate Joe Biden is under fire for fondly reminiscing about his civil relationship with segregationist senators in the 70s and 80s. Speaking at a fundraiser in New York City Tuesday night, Biden expressed nostalgia for his relationship with the late Democratic pro-segregation senators James Eastland of Mississippi and Herman Talmadge of Georgia. Biden reportedly said, quote, "I was in a caucus with James O. Eastland. He never called me boy. He called me son." Biden went on to say, quote, "A guy like Herman Talmadge, one of the meanest guys I ever knew. You go down the list, all of these guys, well, guess what? At least there was some civility. We got things done," Biden said. New Jersey Senator and 2020 Democratic candidate Cory Booker responded to the remarks in a statement saying, quote, "Vice President Biden's relationships with proud segregationists are not the model for how we make America a safer and more inclusive place for Black people and for everyone. He's wrong for using his relationships with Eastland and Talmadge as examples of how to bring our country together." Booker has called for Biden to apologize. This is Biden's response.
Are you going to apologize? Like Cory Booker
apologize
has called for
it? What?
Cory Booker's called for it.
Cory should apologize. He knows better. There's not a racist bone in my body. I've been involved in civil rights my whole career. Period. Period. Period.
Senator Booker was not the only presidential candidate to call out Vice President Biden. California Senator Kamala Harris accused Biden of coddling the reputations of segregationists. Senators Warren, Sanders, and New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio also condemned Biden's remarks. Former White House Communications Director Hope Hicks appeared before Congress Wednesday in a closed-door session where she refused to answer most questions about her time in the White House. White House counsel said Hicks was immune from answering questions about her time working as an advisor to President Trump, a claim dismissed by Judiciary Chair Jerry Nadler, who said it was ridiculous and Democrats would destroy it in court. Lawmakers subpoenaed Hicks as part of their investigation into Trump's potential obstruction of justice, corruption, and abuse of power. Hicks did not respond to some questions about her involvement in Trump's 2016 campaign and was reportedly asked what she knew about contacts between Trump associates and Russia. She also reportedly shared she was unaware of any hush money payments made in the run-up to 2016 elections. Hope Hicks now serves as executive and chief communications officer at Fox Corporation, the parent company of Fox News. In environmental news, the Trump administration's replaced an Obama-era energy rule, which was designed to close older coal plants and tighten emissions restrictions. The new rules announced by the Environmental Protection Agency Wednesday allow states to set regulations for emissions and decide whether coal-fired plants should make improvements. Obama's Clean Power Plan sought to lower carbon emissions through federal regulations, but the plan never took effect due to multiple legal challenges from energy companies and some states. Michael Brune, executive director of the Sierra Club, said, quote, "Trump and EPA Administrator Wheeler are pushing a plan that will lead to thousands of deaths while ignoring the public's demands for aggressive climate action just so a handful of wealthy coal executives can make a little more money. This is an immoral and an illegal attack on clean air, clean energy, and the health of the public," Brune said. Legal challenges from at least six states and multiple environmental groups are expected. On Tuesday, Trump touted his energy policies during his first 2020 campaign rally in Florida.
"We are creating a future of American energy independence, and yet our air and water are the cleanest they've ever been by far."
Research by the American Lung Association refutes Trump's lies. The group found that over 4 in 10 Americans live with unhealthy air due to high levels of pollution and dangerous climate change-induced ozone levels. The poor air quality can cause, quote, "premature death and serious health effects such as lung cancer, asthma attacks, cardiovascular damage, and developmental and reproductive harm." Again, this according to the American Lung Association. Chinese President Xi Jinping is in North Korea to meet with Kim Jong-un, marking his first presidential trip to North Korea and the first Chinese state visit to North Korea since 2005. The two leaders are expected to discuss the contentious denuclearization negotiations with the U.S., which stalled after President Trump walked away from talks at a summit in Vietnam in February. Kim and Xi will also discuss the current state of trade relations between the two countries, which have been severely impacted under current sanctions against North Korea. President Xi is expected to meet with Trump at the G20 summit in Japan at the end of the month amidst a mounting trade war between China and the United States. A new UN report finds nearly 71 million people were displaced last year by war, persecution, and other forms of violence. That number is more than 2 million people higher than the preceding year and represents a jump of 65% from a decade ago. Nearly 26 million refugees were recorded in 2018, over half of them under the age of 18. Of those, less than 100,000 were resettled. Over 41 million people worldwide were internally displaced, and 3.5 million were registered as asylum seekers. Syria represents the highest number of refugees at 6.7 million, while Ethiopians represented the largest newly displaced population last year, the vast majority internally displaced due to intercommunal conflict. The annual report by the UN Refugee Agency was released to coincide with World Refugee Day, which is today. International investigators said Wednesday three Russians and one Ukrainian will be charged with murder for launching a missile that downed a Malaysia Airlines flight in 2014 over eastern Ukraine. The investigators say the plane was shot down by a Russian missile, though Russia has denied involvement in the attack. MH17 was en route from Amsterdam to Kuala Lumpur, carrying people from 17 different countries. All 298 people on board were killed in the attack. Prosecutors say a trial in a Dutch court will be held next March. The suspects will likely be tried in absentia, as Ukraine and Russia both have laws protecting citizens from extradition. Back in the U.S., the House Budget Committee held a hearing on poverty in America. Reverend Dr. William Barber, co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, called for a moral budget, framing the epidemic of poverty as a moral crisis.
It is tragic in a society where our first constitutional duty is to establish justice and promote the general welfare, that we will allow the injustice of poverty. 43.5% of poor people are poverty and low wealth, and people here who could teach this society, and we would walk away from our constitutional values and walk away from our spiritual values that tell us that it is dangerous for a nation not to lift up the poor.
Reverend Dr. Barber called the systemic inequalities in the United States a direct result of policy decisions that work to keep 140 million people in conditions of poverty. In California, Democratic Governor Gavin Newsom apologized Tuesday for his state's, quote, systemic slaughter of California Indians, unquote. Governor Newsom issued the apology, which accompanies an executive order, at the site of the future Indian Heritage Center in Sacramento, where he spoke before a group of tribal leaders. Governor Newsom told them, it's called genocide. No other way to describe it, and that's the way it needs to be described in the history books, he said. Newsom also announced the creation of a Truth and Healing Council. In 1850, California passed a law allowing for the separation of Native American families, their removal from tribal territories, and the creation of a system of indentured servitude. The Los Angeles Times reports California's Native American population declined from about 150,000 to 30,000 between 1846 and 1879. Daniel Salgado of the Cuya Band of Indians told the L.A. Times he appreciated Governor Newsom's actions and that, quote, in any kind of relationship, there's recognition of a wrongdoing, an apology, and a healing starts to take place. And poet, musician, and writer Joy Harjo has become the first Native American poet laureate. Harjo, a member of the Muscogee Creek Nation, is the author of 8 poetry books, including the celebrated In Mad Love and War, which won the American Book Award in 1990, as well as a memoir and stories for children and young adults. Harjo told the New York Times, "Just as when I started writing poetry, we're at a crucial time in American history and in a planetary history. Poetry is a way to bridge, to make bridges from one country to another, one person to another, one time to another," she said. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Nermeen Sheikh. Welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. On Wednesday, a subcommittee of the House Judiciary held a historic hearing on reparations for slavery, the first of its kind in over a decade. Wednesday's hearing coincided with Juneteenth, a day that commemorates June 19, 1865, when slaves in Galveston, Texas, finally learned that the Emancipation Proclamation had abolished slavery. This year marks the 400th anniversary of the transatlantic slave trade. Lawmakers are considering a bill titled the Commission to Study and Develop Reparation Proposals for African Americans Act. The bill was introduced by Democratic Representative Sheila Jackson Lee of Houston this year, after former Congressmember John Conyers had championed the bill for decades without success. The bill carries the designation H.R. 40, a reference to 40 acres and a mule, one of the nation's first broken promises to newly freed slaves. Ahead of the hearing, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell was asked by reporter Eva McKend of Spectrum News whether the government should issue a public apology for slavery.
I don't think reparations for something that happened 150 years ago, for whom none of us currently living are responsible, is a good idea. We've tried to deal with our original sin of slavery by fighting a civil war, by passing landmark civil rights legislation. We've elected an African-American president. I think we're always a work in progress in this country, but no one currently alive was responsible for that. And I don't think we should be trying to figure out how to compensate for it. First of all, it'd be pretty hard to figure out who to compensate. We've had waves of immigrants as well who've come to the country and experienced dramatic discrimination of one kind or another. So, no, I don't think reparations are a good idea.
That was Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell. Well, on Wednesday, the award-winning author Ta-Nehisi Coates testified at the historic congressional hearing on reparations and took direct aim at McConnell.
Yesterday, when asked about reparations, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell offered a familiar reply. America should not be held liable for something that happened 150 years ago, since none of us currently alive are responsible. This rebuttal proffers a strange theory of governance, that American accounts are somehow bound by the lifetime of its generations. But well into this century, the United States was still paying out pensions to the heirs of Civil War soldiers. We honor treaties that date back some 200 years, despite no one being alive who signed those treaties. Many of us would love to be taxed for the things we are solely and individually responsible for. But we are American citizens and thus bound to a collective enterprise that extends beyond our individual and personal reach. It would seem ridiculous to dispute invocations of the founders or the greatest generation on the basis of a lack of membership in either group. We recognize our lineage as a generational trust, as inheritance. And the real dilemma posed by reparations is just that, a dilemma of inheritance. It is impossible to imagine America without the inheritance of slavery. As historian Ed Baptist has written, enslavement, quote, shaped every crucial aspect of the economy and politics of America, so that by 1836, more than 600 million, or almost half of the economic activity in the United States, derived directly or indirectly from the cotton produced by the million-odd slaves. By the time the enslaved were emancipated, they comprised the largest single asset in America, $3 billion in 1860 more than all the other assets in the country combined. The method of cultivating this asset was neither gentle cajoling nor persuasion, but torture, rape, and child trafficking. Enslavement reigned for 250 years on these shores. When it ended, this country could have extended its hallowed principles, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness to all, regardless of color. But America had other principles in mind. And so, for a century after the Civil War, black people were subjected to a relentless campaign of terror, a campaign that extended well into the lifetime of Majority Leader McConnell. It is tempting to divorce this modern campaign of terror, of plunder, from enslavement. But the logic of enslavement, of white supremacy, respects no such borders. And the god of bondage was lustful and begat many heirs, coup d'etats and convict leasing, vagrancy laws and debt peonage, redlining and racist GI bills, poll taxes and state-sponsored terrorism. We grant that Mr. McConnell was not alive for Appomattox, but he was alive for the electrocution of George Stinney. He was alive for the blinding of Isaac Woodward. He was alive to witness kleptocracy in his native Alabama and a regime premised on electoral theft. Majority Leader McConnell cited civil rights legislation yesterday, as well he should, because he was alive to witness the harassment, jailing, and betrayal of those responsible for that legislation by a government sworn to protect them. He was alive for the redlining of Chicago and the looting of black homeowners of some $4 billion. Victims of that plunder are very much alive today. I am sure they'd love a word with the Majority Leader. What they know, what this committee must know, is that while emancipation deadbolted the door against the bandits of America, Jim Crow wedged the windows wide open. And that is the thing about Senator McConnell's something. It was 150 years ago, and it was right now. The typical black family in this country has one-tenth the wealth of the typical white family. Black women die in childbirth at four times the rate of white women. And there is, of course, the shame of this land of the free, boasting the largest prison population on the planet, of which the descendants of the enslaved make up the largest share. The matter of reparations is one of making amends and direct redress, but it is also a question of citizenship. In H.R. 40, this body has a chance to both make good on its 2009 apology for enslavement and reject fair-weather patriotism, to say that a nation is both its credits and its debits, that if Thomas Jefferson matters, so does Sally Hemings, that if D-Day matters, so does Black Wall Street, that if Valley Forge matters, so does Fort Pillow. Because the question really is not whether we will be tied to the somethings of our past, but whether we are courageous enough to be tied to the whole of them. Thank you.
That was award-winning author Ta-Nehisi Coates. He was a lead-off witness before the House Judiciary Committee on Wednesday. His seminal 2014 essay, The Case for Reparations, helped spur new calls to make amends for slavery. When we come back, he joins us for the rest of the hour. Shimmer, Prayer for Cleaning the Water, by poet and musician Joy Harjo, who's become the first Native American poet laureate. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
As we continue to talk about the call for slavery reparations, we spend the rest of the hour with Ta-Nehisi Coates, who testified at Wednesday's hearing. He's the author of several books, including We Were 8 Years in Power, An American Tragedy. He's also the author of Between the World and Me, for which he received the 2015 National Book Award for Nonfiction. He's now a writer in residence at New York University.
Ta-Nehisi Coates' seminal 2014 essay, The Case for Reparations, helped spur new calls to make amends for slavery. Today, he joins us for the hour. Ta-Nehisi, thanks so much for being with us. Can you talk about the origins of this hearing, the first in a dozen years, and the bill that is being considered and what you hope to come of this? Did you ever dream that this is what would come of, well, it's been going on for decades, but 5 years ago you intensified the discussion with your Atlantic piece on reparations?
Yeah, no, it's been—I have to be honest, it's been absolutely fascinating to watch. I think the thing that people need to understand about the fight for reparations is precisely how old it is. I mean, this goes back to Belinda Royal, who sued the estate of Isaac Royal back in, you know, post-colonial times after the American Revolution, up through Callie House in the 19th century, into James Forman Sr., who was a leader at SNCC, making his demand for reparations, up through Encobra, and people like Professor Charles Ogletree. So this is a long, long fight. And when I published The Case for Reparations in The Atlantic, my hope was to just make my entry into that fight. I didn't expect it to quite get here. I think this is definitely progress. I don't think this is anywhere near the end goal. But I think yesterday was progress.
Well, Ta-Nehisi, you made, of course, a number of extremely powerful remarks during your testimony, among which you said, quote, "It's impossible to imagine America without the inheritance of slavery." So for our international audience and others who aren't quite as familiar with this history, could you explain what you mean by that? It's impossible to understand America without this inheritance.
Well, sure. You know, the two great crimes in American history is obviously the, you know, destruction of this country's Native American, the near destruction, I should say, not the destruction, the near destruction of this country's Native American population, the theft of their land. And on to work that land was brought in Native Africans into this country beginning in 1619. Those twin processes profoundly altered the shape of the world and made this country possible. Obviously, first of all, you know, the land on which, you know, America and Americans currently reside was the land of Native Americans. But the people brought in to break that land just transformed it. The profits derived from slavery are more extreme than I think are commonly acknowledged. As I said yesterday, in 1860, the combined worth of the 4 million enslaved black people in this country was some $3 billion, nearly $75 billion in today's share of dollars. Cotton in 1860 was this country's largest export, not just its largest export. It was the majority of exports out of this country. So from a financial perspective, just the economics of it, it's absolutely impossible to imagine America without enslavement. The onset of the Civil War, the greatest preponderance, the greatest population per capita of millionaires and multimillionaires in this country was in the Mississippi River Valley. It wasn't in Boston, wasn't in Chicago, wasn't in New York. The richest people in this country were slaveholders. Most of our earliest presidents were slaveholders. And the fact that they were presidents is not incidental to the fact that they're their slaveholding. That was how they built their wealth. That was how Thomas Jefferson built his wealth. That was how George Washington built his wealth. Individual slaves were the equivalent of, say, owning a home today. They were people, but turned into objects of extreme wealth. So just from the economic perspective, there's that. And just forgive me for extending a little bit, but there's also the fact of what America actually is culturally. Our greatest export today is our entertainment and it is our culture. It is impossible to imagine American culture without jazz, without the blues, without hip-hop. It's impossible to imagine American cinema without, regrettably, Birth of a Nation. It's impossible to imagine American literature at this point without James Baldwin, without Toni Morrison. All of these are the primary, secondary, and tertiary fruits of slavery. And so if you strip slavery out of America, if you strip black people out of America, you really don't have an America.
Ta-Nehisi Coates, I wanted to go to a clip of you speaking at this historic hearing yesterday before the House Judiciary Committee chair, answering Chairman Jerry Nadler.
It's been said, I think, or alluded to repeatedly throughout this conversation that somehow wealthy African Americans are immune to these effects. But in addition to the wealth gap that's cited, one thing that folks should keep in mind is that quote-unquote wealthy African Americans are not the equivalent of quote-unquote wealthy white Americans in this country. The average African American family in this country making $100,000, just, you know, decent money, actually lives in the same kind of neighborhood that the average white family making $35,000 a year lives in. That is totally tied to the legacy of enslavement and Jim Crow, and the input and the idea in the mind that white people and black people are somehow deserving of different things. If I injure you, the injury persists even after I actually commit the act. If I stab you, you may suffer complications long after that initial actual stabbing. If I shoot you, you may suffer complications long after that initial shooting. That's the case with African Americans. There are people well within the living memory of this country that are still suffering from the after effects of that.
Thank you very much.
So that is Ta-Nehisi Coates speaking at the hearing. And with that, I want to go back to just a clip of what the Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell said.
I heard it said just earlier, for instance, that
I don't think reparations for something that happened 150 years ago, for whom none of us currently living are responsible, is a good idea. We've, you know, tried to deal with our original sin of slavery by fighting a civil war, by passing landmark civil rights legislation. We've elected an African-American president.
So I want to point out that the question that he was asked about reparations, about apologies for slavery, was asked by a young African-American reporter named Eva McKend of Spectrum. His comment is being heard everywhere, but the reporter herself is only being talked about on Democracy Now! And the significance of this, Ta-Nehisi, and then if you can talk about the bill that's being considered. I mean, you yourself said when you started your historic piece 5 years ago on the case for reparations, you yourself weren't convinced.
Yeah, and first of all, I want to thank you for, shouting out that reporter. That actually has meaning, because you need a black reporter there in the first place to actually ask the question to, you know, set all of this in motion. So that's true. No. And to be honest with you, for instance, the previous answer I just gave you on, A, the economics of enslavement and its relationship to this country— I would not have been able to give you that answer. When I started in 2014, I actually was, at that point, for reparations, but you're referring back to something I wrote in 2012 when I was, against. I wouldn't have been able to give you that answer. I didn't have that level of knowledge. And beyond that, I didn't have the level of knowledge on how it persisted. I mean, I had a vague sense of segregation, Jim Crow, et cetera, you know, in the 100 years after. But I didn't know about redlining. Not in that degree of detail. And I didn't know how this extraction, as I call it, of wealth from the African-American community laundered through the state into the white community, you know, through redlining, through the FHA loan program, through the GI Bill. I just didn't have knowledge of that. And once I saw that, it's like, wow, this is a persistent, you know, a pattern of extraction that needs a really, really radical answer. At that point, reparations made total sense to me. But I will add that it made sense to plenty of people long before it made sense to me.
Mm. And Ta-Nehisi, could you talk about, I mean, how do you think conversations about reparations in the American public sphere have changed since the publication of your Atlantic piece?
You know, I'm not, you know, that piece got a lot of attention. I'm not totally convinced that that's why this is happening right now. I just really want to say again that the people have been fighting this battle for a long time, and so it's like you put drops of, you know, water in a glass, and eventually, you know, the glass tips over, and you see some sort of larger effect. I was building on the work, you know, when I published in 2014, only, what, 10, 15 years ago, you know, there had been Randall Robinson's The Debt, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the efforts of Charles Oak. So there have been all of these little, you know, sort of efforts that didn't get the same degree of coverage. That's the first thing. And I also think having your first black president followed up by, you know, someone who I've referred to as your first white president has had a tremendously radicalizing effect on a lot of people. Mm.
Can you talk about, I mean, this discussion about reparations immediately last night on the talk shows, what are they talking about? Giving checks? Who exactly would be involved? Who would get the money? How would this be determined? Go back to when Abraham Lincoln signed a bill emancipating enslaved people. The slave owners around Washington, D.C., being given reparations for each enslaved right. person that they freed. Right. What was it, $300 a person?
Right. I can't remember the number, but yeah, you're exactly correct. And in fact, Lincoln offered that to several. He did this idea of what it was called, compensated emancipation at the time. And he offered it to several of the border slave states, Delaware, I believe, Maryland, Kentucky. Also, that was a plan to compensate the actual slaveholders. And I should say that that's a global pattern throughout history. The country of Haiti, for having the temerity to actually liberate itself from enslavers, was forced to pay reparations to France, the country that had actually enslaved the people there. So this is a global pattern, you know, with people enslaved. It is only for questions of power that, you know, we find ourselves able to countenance the idea that people who have done the enslaving should have been compensated, and that was fine. And not just people who were enslaved, but people who are suffering the effects of that afterwards should not be compensated.
So talk about
Can I add one quick thing also, Amy? This whole thing about who should get a check and should we cut checks, you know, I understand those questions. That's great. Those people should support H.R. 40, though. Because that's what H.R. 40 does. It tries to get that figured out and get that math figured out and figure out the best way to do it. But if we don't actually have a study, we can't actually answer those questions. You can't ask a doctor to make a diagnosis before there's an actual examination. Those people who have all of those questions to support H.R. 40, they should be his biggest supporters.
Well, Ta-Nehisi Coates, I want to go back to some of the enduring legacy of slavery in the U.S. The House Budget Committee held a hearing on poverty in America, and Reverend Dr. William Barber, co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, called for a moral budget, framing the epidemic of poverty as a, quote, moral crisis.
It is tragic in a society where our first constitutional duty is to establish justice and promote the general welfare, that we will allow the injustice of poverty. 43.5% of poor people are poverty and low wealth, and people here who could teach this society, and we would walk away from our constitutional values and walk away from our spiritual values that tell us that it is dangerous for a nation not to lift up the poor.
Reverend Dr. Barber is wearing a sash that says Jesus was a poor man. And I just want to point out, so you're having this hearing on Juneteenth, and the Budget Committee is having this historic hearing on Juneteenth, and you're actually speaking at exactly the same time. That hearing culminated 3 days of the Poor People's Campaign, of course, picked up from the last year of Dr. Martin Luther King's life as he led the Poor People's Campaign. Democracy Now! Was there on Monday at the Trinity University when Dr. Barber and Dr. Liz Theo Harris questioned 9 presidential candidates about this issue of the connections of poverty and racism, saying this issue of extreme poverty was not raised once in one of the presidential debates of 2016. Can you talk about this trajectory from slavery to what we're describing today?
Yeah. I mean, again, I think in this moment, you know, one of the reasons why, you know, this sort of you know, all of these questions that, that may have been, you know, off of the table in 2016 or off the table in 2008, it's not that people weren't raising them. You know, it's not that, you know, people weren't making a point. But I just think, you know, in reaction to what's going on to this country, in this country right now, people are just much, much more open. You know, and in terms of poverty and race in this country, again, you know, one of the things that I really, really wanted to stress is it's the level of poverty specifically that you see in the African-American community. It's not accidental. It's not accidental. This was this is part of the process. The process of enslavement involves stealing something from someone. It involves taking someone something from someone. Jim Crow was theft. First and foremost, it was theft. If I tax you, or if I tell you you have to be loyal to this country and pledge fealty to its laws, but then I don't give you the same degree of protection, I don't give you the same access to resources that I give to another group of people, I have effectively stolen something from you. I've stolen your tax money. I've stolen your fealty. I've stolen your loyalty. So when the state of Mississippi, for instance, you know, taxes black people and then builds, you know, one facility for education and another one facility for education for whites and then an inferior facility for blacks, that's theft. That's theft. If I build a you know, a public pool system and then tell you you can't use that public pool system, that's theft. And so that is the long history, you know, of this country that doesn't end, again, conservatively until, you know, 1968. And so there are people who are very, very much alive who've experienced that, who are suffering the after effects and effects of that. And that's what, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, the whole movement around reparations is about. And I, you know, suspect I didn't hear, you know, Dr. Reverend Barber's comments, but I suspect there's quite a bit of overlap there, too.
Well, I want to ask Ta-Nehisi about what may be a changing perception of the position that the African-American community in the U.S. is in and a possible change in what ought to be done about it. A recent survey by the Associated Press found that 52% of Americans believe the government doesn't put enough resources into improving the conditions of African-Americans, but only 30% think the government is obliged to compensate for past racial discrimination. Your response to that and the distinction between the two?
I think people have, you know, I said this yesterday, I think people are very, very uncomfortable when we start talking about the things in America's past that do not credit us. Again, we have no problem at all taking credit for the things that, you know, people who, you know, are no longer here, you know, who were in our past. We have no problem taking credit for those, their efforts. You know, you take somebody like Mitch McConnell, who does not want to be responsible for, you know, enslavement that happened 150 years ago, but yet and still wants the right to operate his, you know, operate his business or operate his, you know, his career in a building that was built by enslaved people. And so we have no problem taking the credits, the benefits, you know, for what was done in our past. But when you start talking, you know, to people about actually paying that, you know, back or actually, you know, some sort of evenness around that, there, you know, a lot of discomfort comes up. I understand that. I would like to also, you know, take only, you know, my paycheck and not have to pay my bills. I would like that, too. That would be great. You know, but I think if this idea of patriotism and citizenship is, you know, to mean anything, you know, you can't, you know, as I say, be a fair weather friend to your country. You can't, you know, decide that your past only matters, you know, that you want to invoke, you know, your country as a land of the free when you want to go invade Iraq, for instance. And then, you know, when you're being called to be responsible for what made, you know, it possible for that country to be called land of the free in the first place, to act like, you know, you don't owe anybody anything, or you're not part of this, especially, you know, as I said yesterday, when a lot of this happened in your own lifetime. It isn't the past. It happened while you were alive. Mitch McConnell was 26 years old by the time the Voting Rights Act was passed. You know, so this is very well within the lifetime of living people today.
I want to go to Coleman Hughes, the columnist for Quillette, undergraduate at Columbia University, who spoke out against reparations.
I understand that reparations are about what people are owed, regardless of how well they're doing. I understand that. But the people who are owed for slavery are no longer here. and we are not entitled to collect on their debts. Reparations, by definition, are only given to victims. So the moment you give me reparations, you've made me into a victim without my consent.
Ta-Nehisi Coates, can you respond to Coleman Hughes, who testified at the same hearing that you led off?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the testimony was that one should not receive payment that would probably properly be due to the enslaved. But this country is, to this very day, receiving payment that was due to its enslavers. That's the way inheritance works, you know, in this country. However, you know, one might feel about that. If I assemble a mass of money, I have the right to pass that on to my kid. My kid has the right to do whatever and then pass it on, you know, to their kid. And so there's something fundamentally unjust. If I have secured that money by taking it from one group and then I pass that money on to my kid. My kid, by the way, continues to do injustice to the descendants of that other group. And we're allowed to continually collect. I don't want to fall into this trap. And I really, really tried to make this clear yesterday. This didn't end with enslavement. Reparations isn't just about enslavement. There was the 250 years of enslavement, that period of theft. After that, there was 100 years of terror, that period of theft. And, you know, I would argue, in fact, our present system of mass incarceration emerges right out of that. And so, you know, this notion that a nation somehow only, especially when we're talking about its debits, that it only lasts through the lifetime of its present generation is clearly ridiculous. The state itself would fall apart if that were true. If all of our treaties were broken when this generation died, if all of our taxes and responsibilities, if we said to pensioners, you know, we will no longer pay you because the people that, you know, made the decisions about those wars are no longer alive, we would have a huge problem. As I said yesterday, to this very day, or at least I should say as recently as 2017, we were paying pensions to the heirs of Civil War widows. I mean, this is tremendous that we would recognize our ties to the past when it comes to certain things, but not other things.
Ta-Nehisi Coates, we have to break. And I also want to point out Ta-Nehisi is speaking to us from Washington, D.C., where he testified yesterday, and he's speaking in front of an image of the Capitol, which was built by enslaved people. Ta-Nehisi Coates, writer in residence at New York University, author of a number of books, including We Were 8 Years in Power, an American Tragedy, that includes his case against reparations, his case for reparations. We'll be back with Ta-Nehisi in a minute.
I was standing by my window on a cold and cloudy day when I saw the words come around.
The circle be unbroken by the Staple Singers. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
Democratic presidential contender Joe Biden is under fire for fondly reminiscing about his civil relationship with segregationist senators in the 1970s and 1980s. Speaking at a fundraiser at the Carlyle Hotel in New York City Tuesday night, Biden expressed nostalgia for his relationship with the late Democratic pro-segregation senators James Eastland of Mississippi and Herman Talmadge of Georgia. Biden reportedly said, quote, "I was in a caucus with James Eastland. He never called me boy. He called me son," Biden said.
Biden went on to say, a guy like Herman Talmadge, one of the meanest guys I ever know, you go down the list of all these guys, well, guess what? At least there was some civility. We got things done. Biden was widely criticized by other Democratic presidential contenders. He was asked on Wednesday if he would apologize.
Are you going to apologize? Like Cory Booker
apologize
has called for
what?
Cory Booker's called for it.
Cory should apologize. He knows better. There's not a racist bone in my body. I've been involved in civil rights my whole career. Period. Period. Period.
Biden spoke after Senator Cory Booker had issued a statement reading, quote, Vice President Biden's relationships with proud segregationists are not the model for how we make America a safer and more inclusive place for black people and for everyone. Frankly, I'm disappointed that he hasn't issued an immediate apology for the pain his words are dredging up for many Americans. He should, Booker said.
Other candidates also weighed in. Senator Bernie Sanders tweeted, I agree with Cory Booker. This is especially true at a time when the Trump administration is trying to divide us up with its racist appeals. New York Mayor Bill de Blasio posted a photo of his family on Twitter and wrote, quote, it's 2019 and Joe Biden is longing for the good old days of civility typified by James Eastland. Eastland thought my multiracial family should be illegal and that whites were entitled to the pursuit of dead N-words. Senator Kamala Harris said, quote, yes, it concerns me deeply. If those men had their way, I would not be in the United States Senate. Senator Elizabeth Warren said, quote, I'm not here to criticize other Democrats, but it's never okay to celebrate segregationists. Never. Ta-Nehisi Coates, your thoughts.
I mean, it's just more of the same. It's just more of the same. I mean, you know,
Joe Biden says, Biden apologize? You know,
I mean, Joe Biden shouldn't be president. You know, obviously, I don't think I'm breaking any news here. You know, if he ends up being the nominee, better him than Trump. But, you know, I think that's a really, really low standard. I think when you have somebody who is celebrating their relationship, the ability of, you know, a person who saw no problem depriving an entire, you know, population of African Americans in their state of the right to vote. The right to participate as American citizens, the fact that that person was polite to them. I mean, it's nice that Eastland never called, or Talmadge, whoever it was, never called Joe Biden boy. It's nice that Joe Biden had that privilege. But the fact of the matter is Joe Biden owes his very presence in the race right now to the first black president, to Barack Obama. And if it were up to Eastland and if it were up to Talmadge, Barack Obama would not only not be in the White House, he actually would not exist. And so I don't know what is, you know, going on in your brain where, you decide to celebrate the fact that these people were polite. They could afford to be polite because the major opposition, you know, in their state, that being African-Americans, was effectively at that time, in their time, through the, you know, most of their career, wiped out of the political process and erased as an electorate. You know, Joe Biden says that— he's been involved with civil rights his entire career. It's worth remembering Joe Biden opposed busing and bragged about it, you know, in the 1970s. Joe Biden, you know, is on the record as being to the right of actually the new Democrats in the 1990s on the issue of mass incarceration. Wanted more people sentenced to the death penalty. Wanted more jails. And so I'm not surprised. I mean, this is who Joe Biden is. You know, there's that saying, when somebody shows you who they are, believe them. This is who Joe Biden is.
Well, Ta-Nehisi, what about your assessment of the other candidates in the Democratic presidential field?
Right. Are y'all after trying to get me again, huh?
After your piece was published
before.
In The Atlantic, you met with Elizabeth Warren.
I did. Yes, I did.
Can you talk about that?
No. No, not this time.
But Ta-Nehisi, what are you paying particular attention to with these candidates? I mean, it was interesting yesterday after Biden made his comments to donors on Tuesday night and said, you know, Eastland didn't call me boy, he called me son. Now, again, Senator Eastland, who talked about African Americans as the inferior race, was called the voice of the white South. Yes, as you pointed out, obviously. So he didn't call him boy. Joe Biden is white. But mm-hmm. your The first two people to speak out, as far as I could tell, were first Cory Booker, and then he referred to Cory immediately as Cory and said Cory should apologize to him, Joe Biden. Mm-hmm. And then, as well, you had Kamala Harris speaking out, the African-American senator from mm-hmm. California. And then, of course, Warren and Biden, mm-hmm. Rather Warren and Bernie Sanders and de Blasio. But what are you looking for in these candidates, the stands you want to see them taking?
I think I would like to see somebody it's understandable where a large portion of this country is. They want to see somebody who can beat Trump. I get that. And there is, you know, a feeling, I think, among certain people that Joe Biden can out white man Donald Trump. I'm not convinced of that. I don't think anybody can out white man Donald Trump. I hope that what we'll see eventually is something more than I can beat Donald Trump. Like, I can beat Donald Trump should be the floor. I get that beating Donald Trump is extremely, extremely important. I get that. But I just hope that that's the floor, you know, and not the ceiling.
Well, one of the leading contenders is Senator Bernie Sanders in the 2020 mm-hmm. Upcoming elections. So I'd like to go to him being questioned about the issue of reparations by The View's Sonny mm-hmm. Hostin earlier this year.
I happen to believe that at a time of tremendous disparity, the wealth gap, for example, between the white community and the black community is like 10 to 1. Health disparities are terrible. Environmental disparities are terrible. Flint, Michigan comes to mind. Yeah. So I think what we have got to do is pay attention to distressed communities, black communities, Latino communities, and white communities all over this country. And as president, I pledge to do that.
Reparations.
Well, what do you mean by reparations?
By reparations for slave defense.
I know, but what does that mean exactly?
Money.
Well, I think that right now our job is to address the crises facing the American people and our communities. And I think there are better ways to do that than just writing out a check.
So that's Senator Bernie Sanders. Your response, Ta-Nehisi, to his position on reparations?
Well, I think I should say before I, you know, say that, my understanding is that Senator Sanders now supports H.R. 40. I think that's where we are now. And so I'm you know, obviously pretty pleased about that. You know, listen, when we had this dust up a few years ago, what I was repeatedly told was, you know, it's not class, you know, or race. It's both. And I agree. So I think all of the things that, you know, Bernie Sanders just listed about, you know, paying attention to distressed communities should be done. And we should also have reparations. So I don't see those two things as in conflict. It's not clear to me why, you know, both can't be on the agenda. In fact, it was never clear to me why both can't be on the agenda, why one can't, you know, associate themselves, you know, with the massive gaps in wealth that don't just exist in the African-American community, but exist, you know, in communities across the country, and at the same time recognize that there's something specific about the gap in the African-American community that's tied to the specificity of American history. But, you know, as I said, I'm happy Senator Sanders now supports H.R. 40. I think that's progress. Mm.
And finally, where does this bill go from here? And talk about even its name, H.R. 40, where it comes from.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, it comes from the field order given by General Sherman. The whole 40 acres and a mule, this is a reference back to that. I don't know where this goes. I don't know where this goes. I'm shocked we're here. I've said that repeatedly. I'm surprised we're even here. I am a writer and a journalist, you know, soon-to-be novelist. Those are my preoccupations. That's my disposition. I'm not a very good prognosticator. I would not have told you that you would have had a black president in 2008. I would not have told you that, you know, there would have been hearings, you know, on the House floor on reparations, on H.R. 40. I would not have predicted any of that. So I don't know where we go. I think, you know, in my mind, you know, I try not to get too high and try not to get too low, as it said. In my mind, this is still a generational struggle. And that's how I'm seeing it. I expect to, you know, that generations after I'm gone will continue to fight this battle, because it's always been a generational struggle.
Ta-Nehisi Coates, want to thank you for being with us. Writer in residence at New York University, author of a number of books, including We Were 8 Years in Power, An American Tragedy, Between the World and Me, and his upcoming book, a novel, The Water Dancer. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Thanks so much for joining us.